All right, everybody, we're going to get started. Please grab your seat. Commissioner, you're up here. This session is about Ferguson. This meeting, the 20th anniversary, we talked about President Clinton and the COTS program, but we all know what took place in Ferguson as it related to Michael Brown. And since the day of the shooting, because of the handling of it by the police department, the community's had a violent reaction in Ferguson. And we all know the name of that city is associated with that, which is not a good situation for any of us. What happened in Ferguson beginning on August 9th and what has continued to happen has highlighted the real social issues that must be addressed. The issues are the same that we all face in our communities. Issues around race, class, prejudice, and public safety. They're difficult, which we know, to talk about. Typically, tensions get high and folks get uncomfortable when we talk about a post-racial society in America. But the reality is this: every time a tragedy like Ferguson occurs, we are jolted back into the realization that we are far away from that reality. We cannot let Michael Brown's death become just another statistic, another story. We must learn from this painful experience as mayors and police chiefs so that we can ensure it never happens again. It's our responsibility to ensure that in our respective communities, we don't wait for a tragedy like this to happen in order to take action. It's our responsibility to be proactive in addressing these issues, facing them head on, so that we can put in place the safeguards to avert such tragedies. Our young men of color face very serious challenges in our cities, and as leaders, we must be prepared to act swiftly and justly. The U.S. Conference of Mayors have been active in the national dialogue around Ferguson. Following the shooting, I issued a statement on behalf of the conference. We offered our heartfelt condolences to the family of Michael Brown and urged law enforcement officials and the community that they serve to work together openly to determine exactly what occurred, and applauded President Obama's commitment through the investigation by the Justice Department and FBI. I committed the conference to work with the nation's police chiefs to further identify and implement police department policies that will help prevent such incidences from occurring in the future. On August 21st, we held a conference call. We had Mayor Slade from St. Louis give us an update on the Ferguson situation. The mayors that day called for developing a policy recommendation that will respond to what occurred, and that's in fact what we're doing and still talking about. We began the policy process 10 days ago in Sacramento for U.S. Conference of Mayors leadership, and again, Mayor Slay provided a thoughtful and insightful briefing of that situation. We also had a panel discussion featuring Michael Brown's lawyer, Benjamin Crump, our very own mayor, Karen Freeman Wilson, Salt Lake Police Chief, Chief Chris Burbank was there. And we heard from members of our community in Sacramento as well as other mayors. So for me, this discussion has focused on four things. One, the residents' frustrations. Two, race. Three, relationships. And four, recruitment. And I expect that we'll hear a lot more about these discussions this afternoon. So at this point in time, I'd like to introduce two of the four folks who are going to be speaking on this session. First, on my right, in November of last year, Ron Davis was appointed by Attorney General Holder to head the Office of the COTS program within the Justice Department. For 8 years prior to that appointment, he was Chief of Police in East Palo Alto, where he is credited with leading organizational reform and community policing efforts that have increased public trust and confidence in the police and achieved dramatic crime and violence reductions in that city, once dubbed as the murder capital of the nation. Under Chief Davis's, over a 6-year period, homicides dropped by over 50%, overall crime decreased by 20%, and police and community relations have improved dramatically. One more round of applause for Ron Davis. And to my left, Charles Ramsey, 45 years of law enforcement experience, and since 2008 served as a commissioner of police in the city of Philadelphia. This puts him in command of the fourth largest police department in the nation. Last year, Philadelphia dropped 50% below its peak for homicides in 1990 and experienced fewer violent crimes at any time since 1985. During Commissioner Ramsey's tenure as chief of the Metropolitan Police Department, from 1998 to 2006, crime rates declined in the nation's capital by over 40%. This man has a track record of reducing crime activity. Commissioner Ramsey currently serves as the president of both the Executive Research Forum and the Major Cities Chiefs Association. This is a unique achievement. He's the only law enforcement professional to hold both of these prominent positions. Let's give a round of applause for Commissioner. All right, Ron, if you want to start us off and, you know, take 5-7 minutes, whatever works for you in terms of comments, and then Commissioner will hear from you, and then we'll open it up to a little dialogue.
So thank you, Mr. Mayor, and thank everyone for being here. It's been it's kind of hard to follow this morning, because I thought it was just an exciting morning, and I think the tone that was set was outstanding. I'm going to come back to my outstanding team in a minute, but I don't want to be remiss in that I heard about all the good things that the cops office has done in the last 20 years. And my name was mentioned a few times, but for anybody that's worked with the cops office the last 20 years knows the true leadership behind it and what makes it work to the men and women at the table. So for the cops office, if you could stand up, please. Could you acknowledge this outstanding team? And hopefully you get a chance to meet them and talk to them. They're truly the industry's best, so I'm blessed to work with them. As one of the just issue responding to Ferguson. So the cops office was dispatched to Ferguson, I want to say August 20th, shortly after the shooting of Michael Brown. Now, before that time, we'd actually had received a request to provide technical assistance. And so when I talk about the lessons learned from Ferguson, I'm going to take it from teleconference we had, and at least right now, 3 or 4 different visits we've made to that location. But I'm not going to talk about the shooting. I think former President Clinton said it best. When you deal with people, sometimes things happen, bad or good. I think the investigation into that shooting will determine how that should be handled. So we'll let it take its natural course. But I think what everyone focused on and what we're all concerned about is the events that followed. And in many ways, how that affects not only Ferguson, but the nation as far as all our communities. And so when I look at it, I would say starting from the shooting itself, one of the lessons learned would be actually how we respond to tragic events in our communities. And so, for example, one of the concerns many people in the community have was the issue of how long the body of Michael Brown should have remained on the scene. And so as I look at a lot of things with Ferguson, it really hits home this idea of procedural fairness, legality versus legitimacy. So on one hand, we know that legally we would have the right to process the scene, to lead the victim on the scene, and then we could probably make some very good arguments why. From a community perception and engagement and in relationship point of view, it was very counterproductive, and that started a lot of tensions. Then going to, once the demonstration started, how the police responded to the demonstration. So at the same time, I will tell you this right now, the cops office has been asked by the St. Louis County Police Chief in concurrence with the Highway Patrol for Missouri and along with the City of Ferguson to do a very thorough after action of those departments' response to the demonstrations. But clearly the way we responded also ignited more tensions and things of that nature. But along the way, I think some of the lessons that were learned, if I could just put them in certain categories that stand out, would be, first one would be the area of trust. And if you think about it, we all talk about having this bank of trust, this reserve of trust that we can call upon when things go bad. As I like to put it, is that trust gives what most chiefs would desire, which is a moment of pause. And a moment of pause is that time after such an incident, before people will hit to the streets, that they have confidence, that they'll pause and have confidence in you as the chief and the leadership, that you will basically be fair, you'll do an objective investigation, and that they definitely have a legitimate venue to air their grievances. Without that moment of pause, then we see the kind of things that we're going to look at. So we have to question, what was the trust like beforehand? And many times we say you should build that before the incidents, but we're going to have to start having a conversation and say, that's a given, we know that, but how do you build it if you don't have it? So if you come in day one and then day two this occurs, there's no relationship. Simply telling you that you should have had a relationship probably doesn't work. and we need to find ways, and I think there are many ways that you can still establish relationship in mid-crisis. So some of the lessons learned from there would be, even if you didn't have the relationship, which is very problematic, there's still ways to use the crisis to engage, especially when the community is reaching out and trying to help and trying to respond. And what we saw on the ground is that many people in the community were in fact still trying to engage. The other area that we take a look at is, and I'm gonna borrow a phrase from my good friend Chuck Ramsey when he said optics matter, is what things look like, the response to that, whether it is how we respond to the demonstration, whether it is some of the things we've done. And so a lesson learned is gonna come out of that is that we have to start thinking about, and I think someone mentioned it today, how things look, because the community is judging law enforcement based on that. So that's another lesson. The other area I think is gonna be a big one is crisis management. I would hope now I spent 20 years in Oakland, which is a major city, and then chief of East Palo Alto, which is a, relative to Oakland, is a very small city. And for those who think that something like this can only occur in the Oaklands and the Philadelphias or the Los Angeles, I think this incident, the Trayvon Martin shooting, remind us that it does. The size of the city is not the determining factor for the crisis that may occur, and that whether you have five cops or 5,000, we need to start thinking about how to do this. So one of the big things that will come out of lessons learned, in my opinion, is equipping chiefs with how to deal with crisis management. There were, to say the least, probably some missteps that many in this room would not have done. Things that, you know, would actually pour fuel on the fire versus resolve it. So we need to talk about, once you have multiple agencies, establishing a unified command. We need to understand why you have one single point of contact for the media and making sure that you are providing information to the media so stories are not generated. Understanding how to respond to the demonstration, how to treat the media at a demonstration. Understand thinking through each step that we take. Does it make sense to release a tape at this time? Does it make sense to do an apology in person or on videotape? Does it make sense to engage the community? And if so, how and who? Because all these things that we're seeing is that there's a lot of groups who have been there for a while. There's new groups that pop up. Who has the credibility? Who doesn't? Who do you engage? How do you engage them? The other area I would say, too, is that, you know, is recognize that as a profession that we have not too many things have occurred that have not occurred before, unfortunately, in many ways. And so not to have learned from previous incidents or be able to talk to people that have gone through that would be a huge mistake. And so early on, we connected leaders in Ferguson area to some of the chiefs in this room, Commissioner Ramsey being one and many others, to talk about the issue so we can learn some of the ways that other people have done it. So why weren't there riots following the acquittal of George Zimmerman? Why are there riots? Why are there versus having, you know, violence following the Michael Brown shooting? And what are we gonna look at moving forward when the grand jury makes the decision? But being able to tap into that industry, a lot of people gave credit to the cops office today for great work, and that's 100% right. But the strongest point we have in a cops office, in my opinion, is our ability to do really one thing, help the field advance the field. Not to come up with solutions, because the solutions are out here as I look at you, but to help you advance it. So in many cases, we can convene, we can bring people together, we can bring chiefs together to talk about issues, to learn from each other so the same mistakes are not made, and you can bounce ideas off of people and learn from those. So I think another lesson learned would be is, in a moment of crisis, who can you call as a chief? Can you pick up the phone and say, I have this incident, it's a racial incident, there's violence associated with it, there's demonstration, pick up the phone and start thinking about ways to do it. Because in many ways, the Ferguson response, whether the relationship was there or not, and be pretty clear that it was not, but even engaging it, every day that goes by right now is a missed opportunity to further engage the community and to turn down the temperature that may impact what does happen when a grand jury comes back with their decision. So that's also one of the critical parts. Dealing with the media, it's kind of hard to have the media cover. It was interesting, we had a conversation about the media. It's very hard to, in my opinion, to think that you can get fair coverage or good coverage if you're gassing them and locking them up. So to the extent that you can't do that, that would be a pretty good thing not to do, because I think what happens is the story got changed. And instead of capturing the challenge that was on the front line, if you will, for lack of a better phrase, the narrative was now is how long I could stand on the street before I got stopped and why they're trying to mess with the press and suppress the idea of information. And whether that was, and I offered this as the response, not for the fact, whether that was on the thought of the officer's mind or the leadership is irrelevant. That's how it was portrayed. So as we look at this understanding, we really got to look at, you know, lessons learned of what are the best practices or the better practices of engaging the media during a critical incident so that you can control the narrative or use social media to understand what's going on or to send your message. And so I think there's a lot of lessons that come out of this. Many of the demonstrations are probably going to be formed through social media. So the ability to monitor it, to communicate, to set the standards, to tell people what you're doing, I think we have to start learning about how to use social media. And it makes me think, as I'll close at this part to the speaker's talk, I thought about someone mentioned earlier today, and it might have been my good friend Tom here, about the late Pat Murphy, who was the former commissioner of New York City. And I had an opportunity to hear Pat talk some years ago in Prince George's County. And he said something that stuck with me to this day. And he asked a group of command officers at the time that were going under reform process, are we a vocation or a profession? And I think as we think about that question from the law enforcement point of view, it's one of the most significant questions we need to ask. Are we a vocation or a profession? If we're a profession, then we embrace a national standard of knowledge. If we're a profession, then we have national standards of conduct. If we're a profession, then we do research, we're evidence-based, we have high levels of accountability. We have everything that goes with any other profession that we have, and I think very much we are. And so as we look at the lessons that come out of Ferguson, we should do so through the lens of what can the profession of law enforcement learn, and how do we use it to advance it, and how does community policing come into play? Now, being there on the ground a few times, I would tell you, there's a lot of those solutions that, quite frankly, in my opinion, and this is just my opinion, there were warning signals and alarm bells going off for years. And I think there's some stories where some of the residents themselves had not a clue. You heard the former president talk about that. So one would be is how does the law enforcement and elected officials actually now listen to? The president talked about seeing people, but a part of that is listening to them and, quite frankly, hearing them. Can you hear that, or do you dismiss it as being a perception? Do you dismiss it as being outside agitators, or are you listening to what people are telling you about what's going on in their community, the frustration, the disenfranchisement, what people believe, the trust? If we don't listen, then we will not hear it, and we can't respond to it. So these signals were going off for a very long time. This is just scratching the surface of something that's been there for probably decades. No one person should take the bow of blame, but I think all of us now have to take the responsibility of correction. And so I'm very confident when we do our assessment of the after action that there'll be a lot of lessons learned. I won't get into the question of militarization because I think, as you all know, the president has ordered a review. And so I think we let that review take its place. Many of you here are a part of that process. So we're very confident that we'll get the expert advice and the guidance to see how we have a program that can provide this for the safety of the officers at the same time, not responding to losing trust in the community. And we're also going to have a pattern of practice investigation in Ferguson and a collaborative reform process in St. Louis County. And both of those will also identify lessons learned that you can use as a template in your organizations as leaders. So I think with any tragedy, there comes the phoenix of opportunity to do it better, to do it smarter, and to do it quicker. And so I'm looking forward to that. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much. Very Commissioner.
Good. Very good.
Thank you.
Wherever you like. Who's going to say no to you?
And if I had a uniform, I would go to the podium.
My wife doesn't have any problem saying no all the time. First of all, it's really an honor to be here with you today. And I'm not going to rehash a lot of the things that that Ron Davis said, because I agree with him 100%. There are a lot of lessons here. One of my deputies likes to use the term lessons taught, because it remains to be seen whether or not we learn anything from the events that take place. And I happen to agree with that. But in any event, you know, when you look at Ferguson, for an example, use of force, crime scene protection, handling demonstrations, command and control, all those things are relevant, and all those things are things that we need to certainly look at. But I want to take another perspective on this. And I want to speak as Chuck Ramsey, as opposed to representing any particular police organization. Members may or may not agree with what I am about to say. But I think it's an opportunity here. I mean, this is the 20th anniversary of the COPS office, and we've made a tremendous amount of progress over the past few decades. But there's a lot more that needs to be done. And I think if Ferguson and incidents like Ferguson have shown us anything, it's that we've patted ourselves on the back about all the good things we've done in community policing. But in reality, in my opinion, I think we missed the mark. And I'll tell you why I think we missed the mark, but there's an opportunity here for us to correct course and to change a few things that will certainly make a difference in all of our communities. I mean, when you look at some of the things that took place, and we tend to deal with things after the fact and put in place something pretty hastily to try to deal with issues, and we call it, you know, a sensitivity training or whatever we might want to refer to it as. But I've been in policing a long time. This is my 46th year. And I think a lot of it goes back to how we train officers and how we help them understand their role in a democratic society. Now, the average police academy, and I'm not speaking for all, because I am sure there are some that don't do this, and I apologize beforehand if I offend anybody who happens to be doing these things. The departments that I've worked in, we didn't. We're very good at teaching police officers the technical aspects of policing. Criminal law, what report you make out if you have this particular incident occur, how do you make a felony car stop, how you handcuff folks, how you do all these kinds of things. We're very good at that. But we do not spend any time, or certainly not enough time, helping police officers understand their role in a democratic society, how to engage in constitutional policing, the fact that as police officers, we have a responsibility to protect the constitutional rights of all people. If we can get officers to understand that, then the rest of this stuff starts to fall into place. And we don't have biased policing. We don't have the kinds of things that we witness over and over and over again. I had a reporter downstairs ask me whether or not Ferguson was a wake-up call. And I said, well, I guess you could look at it that way. Problem is, we tend not to stay awake very long. We go back into hibernation very quickly. We're awake during a crisis, and if you think that's not the case, think about Newtown, Connecticut. Think about Sandy Hook. Think about all those babies being slaughtered and how everybody's all up in arms about gun control and all that, and many of those voices have now fallen silent. And if you don't think the deaths of 20 babies can hold your attention, then don't talk to me about how Ferguson is going to hold your attention, because it's not. How do you get past it? How do you get beyond it? How do we put in place a few superficial things that will make people feel a little bit better? Community policing is more than picking up babies and throwing them up in the air. Community policing is more than just one officer forming a relationship, because there's a deep-seated mistrust of police and of government in many of our challenged neighborhoods. And unfortunately, for good reason. We have got to find a way to get at that. Because real community policing means that we've made inroads in our most challenged communities. And folks, we haven't in many instances. I don't think we've actually scratched the surface. Now, I don't have all the answers, but I do know that this next decade of community policing has to be devoted to making inroads in those very communities. Otherwise, we're going to be having this discussion over and over and over again. And we have to face some pretty harsh realities and not let folks just spin everything out of proportion when it comes to, you know, this whole thing about marijuana and decriminalization of marijuana. And, you know, I had people, you know, come to me in media and say, you know, Chief, 80% of the people being arrested for small amounts of marijuana happen to be African American. I said, well, yeah, that's probably true. Philadelphia, I won't challenge that. But 83% of my homicide victims are black. And which stat do you think I care most about? We've got to face the fact that we've got some issues that have to be addressed. And we have to face those issues, and we have to find a way to do it. And police can't do it by themselves. Mayors can't do it by themselves. We have to do it together, folks, because we have that responsibility. And whether you're elected or appointed, we all have one thing in common, and that is trying to make our community stronger, trying to make our community safer. And we can't do it with a lot of bullshit. We have got to be real about it. We've got to make the tough choices, and we got to move forward. And we got to touch the people that right now cannot be touched. President Clinton said something when he said, you know, you look at a priest, you say, I see you. I'd add one thing to that. I see you and I respect you. Because it's the lack of respect in many instances that gets us in trouble. I'll close with one final thing. When I was in Chicago, I had a guy work for me, God rest his soul, by the name of Paris Patton. And he had a gift that not many people have. And that is, he could go into the most volatile situation and within minutes, he could calm it down. He could relate and communicate with folks like I had never seen before. And one day I asked him how he did that. And he told me something that I never forgot. And he said, at the moment of birth, everyone is a perfect 10. But immediately deduct 3 points from that because life is temporary. It doesn't last forever. If you come from a dysfunctional family, take away another 3 because of all the challenges and issues as a young person you're going to face as you're trying to grow up without any real role model. If you're poor, take away another 3. The reason is you're not going to have some opportunities that others have, whether it's educational opportunities or other opportunities. That leaves you 1. That 1 is your dignity and self-respect. That's all some people in our society have left. And if you do something, do your job, do what you have to do, but never, ever do anything that takes away that person's 1 because they will fight you to hold on to it because that's all they got left. Ladies and gentlemen, we got a lot of people out there that find themselves in that situation. And if we really want something called community policing, then we have to earn legitimacy in those communities. We have to understand what it's like to be in those shoes because fate and circumstance is the only thing that separates us as human beings. That's it. A lot of us in this room are only a paycheck or 2 away from being laying on that street corner or whatever. We can't afford to judge others. Respect people. Give them the service they need, even those that are committing crime. Lock them up. You don't have to disrespect them to do it. They come back into the community. What community are they going to come back into? The same challenged communities we're talking about. We got to be ready for that. We got to be able to give them that opportunity. So those are the kinds of things that I think we need to be thinking about, talking about. Where do we go from here? And we need more meetings like this with chiefs and mayors together talking about these issues. This can't be an occasional thing. We need to be doing it on a regular basis because we are in a connected world now. And what happens in one city affects all of us. So it's going to take a collective effort for us to really make a difference. And that's all I got to say about that. Thank you.
Why don't you tell us what you really think? We've been blessed. Yeah, Ron and Commissioner, this is incredible. And I know you guys are in gaga land because these are the kind of discussions that we need to be having and we need to be learning from each other. At this point in time, I'd love for Mayor Slay, I'm going to have you come up and address us from here. Mayor of St. Louis since 2001. Last year made history becoming the first mayor to be elected to a 4th 4-year term by a wide margin. He puts neighborhood safety as a top priority. He adjoins in St. Louis with the Ferguson community, and he's been on the front line on this issue. Let's give a round of applause for Mayor Slay.
Thank you, President Johnson, and good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be here, and I will tell you that I was not surprised, but completely impressed with the presentations by Director Davis and Commissioner Ramsey. They obviously are very, very well versed in these issues and have really given us a lot of great advice and a really important perspective in looking at really what happened in Ferguson and what we can all learn by it and what we can all learn from it. And I can tell you that I'm not going to be able to do a better job than they did, but I can tell you from our perspective back in St. Louis. Now, the city of St. Louis is an incorporated city. We are not part of St. Louis County, and Ferguson is not within my jurisdiction, but it's not far away. So what happened in Ferguson is something that doesn't just affect Ferguson. We all know that, and just doesn't affect the St. Louis region. It affects all of us across the country. And I'm gonna drop the full presentation that I was going to give originally, but what I want to leave you with are a few things that are very much along the lines of what you heard from Director Davis and Commissioner Ramsey. When addressing when the tremendous tragedy occurred in Ferguson, looking at this from the city of St. Louis and from within the St. Louis community, there are a couple of things that stood out very clearly to me. That first and foremost, when talking about this tragedy, that we have to have a high level of sensitivity to what's really happened, and then a high level of sensitivity to what has been going on for a long, long period of time. We have to make sure that we talk about Michael Brown. This was a young 18-year-old African-American young man who just graduated from high school. He was walking in his neighborhood, and he was shot by a police officer in the middle of the day on a very hot day. And his body was left laying on the ground in the middle of the street for hours in front of the community. He was a son with two grieving parents. He had a lot of grieving relatives, and he was part of a community that were in shock and angry about what they saw and what they heard happened. And so anytime you talk about this as a police chief or as a mayor or even as a reporter, any way you do it, you have to make sure that you keep that high level of sensitivity about what really happened. This is a human life. This is a tragedy. Regardless of why it happened or what anybody did, that's something to keep in mind. The other thing is communication. And that's also related to the level of sensitivity. And communicating what happened, it's important that the community has a level of confidence that they're getting accurate information, they're getting someone who is demonstrating a level of respect and a level of concern and compassion for the tragedy that just occurred, and that the community needs to know that there's going to be people in charge who are being responsible in addressing this terrible tragedy. And I think that these gentlemen pretty much gave a very good perspective on what they saw happening and what they thought could have happened in a lot better way. And I'll tell you that, I know this was said, but what really was going on in Ferguson, and I'll tell you a little bit about what Ferguson is. It's a small municipality, about 21,000 people. It's in the suburbs of St. Louis. It's one of 90 municipalities in St. Louis County. It's one of 60 municipalities that has its own police force. 20 years ago, it was 20% African-American, 25% African-American, and now it's just under 70% African-American. So the community has been changing over time. But the government and the department itself has not kept up with that change. It is the police department, I think there are 53 police officers, and three of those are African-American. And they have a council of six members. One is African-American, and the mayor's white. And so I think there's, from my perspective as well, that for far too long there has been a view that the St. Louis County, or St. Louis region for that matter, which is, by the way, I'm not happy to say this, but the St. Louis region is one of the most segregated regions in the state of Missouri. The city of St. Louis itself, on a block-by-block basis, in terms of blacks and whites living on the same block, city of St. Louis itself, which I represent, is one of the most integrated cities in America. But the region itself is one of the most, on that basis, one of the most segregated regions in America. And for far too long, a big part of St. Louis really has felt that what goes on in that neighborhood or what's happening and that municipality doesn't impact me. And I think that talking about an eye-opener or a wake-up call, I hope that the people in St. Louis, and I certainly hope mayors and communities all across America understand, and I know mayors understand it very well, or most mayors, that it does matter what happens in that neighborhood or on that block or in that municipality, or for that matter, even in that city across the state or across the country. So we have a lot of work to do. We have a lot of work to do as mayors. We have a lot of work to do certainly in St. Louis. And some of the things that we're looking at, and to be very clear about some of the issues we're talking about, is that, you know, the shooting has really brought to the surface, really magnified many, many long-seated, deep-seated and long-time held concerns and issues about racial profiling and targeting, concerns about excessive use of force, overall racial disparities in health, education, and economic opportunities. People of color are disproportionately stopped, pulled over, incarcerated, do longer terms of sentence in jail. They're victims of violent crime. They go to failing schools, are more likely to be unemployed or unemployed, live in poor housing, and are suffering from and dying from treatable diseases. I mean, these disparities have really taken the emotion and anger level to really high levels, and has caused the protests and some of the violence and riots that we've seen in Ferguson in particular. And it would be a mistake to broadly characterize the protesters. I think it was said earlier that the protesters are racially diverse and ethnically diverse. They are people from all over the region, all over the country, and are representing various organizations. So these concerns are real. They're something we can't ignore. And we can't just say, oh, we'll throw some money at it, or we'll do a few Band-Aid approaches, and then we'll forget about it, like Sandy Hook and some other huge tragedies that have seemed to fall on deaf ears after a limited period of time. But at the core of what's really happening are generally people of color who are saying we're proud, we're tired of being powerless, and that we're tired of being treated as if we have no value as human beings. And rightly so, they don't just want to be heard. They don't just want us to listen to them. They want positive change, meaningful change that's going to change the way that we deal with each other. A couple of things were said by Attorney General Holder and President Clinton. And I wrote them down very quickly here, if I can find it. But I think President Clinton said that we cannot afford not to know, not to listen to, and know our neighbors. And that's part of what we're talking about here. And General Holder talked about strong relationships founded on mutual respect will build trust and safer neighborhoods. That's what we're looking for. We're looking for strong relationships founded on mutual respect. That takes a lot of work. And it's not just about talking. It's not just about throwing money at things. It's about doing some really structural changes to how we deal with each other. It's about governance. It's about making sure that, I mean, when you look at St. Louis with all these municipalities, and they're all isolated from each other, and they're operated independently of each other. We have some of the most municipalities and government agency entities, I think the second most of any region in America. And I'm not sure that's the best way to govern. Sometimes it feels great. You go back to your community. You come home from work, and you have your own police department. You have your own mayor. You have your own council, and that feels good. But to some degree, we're isolating ourselves from each other. And the issues that we're talking about are, whether it's, again, economic disparities, whether it's homelessness, whether it's crime, all those things that affect some communities more than others, these are regional issues. They're regional economies, regional workforces, regional assets, regional resources that we can use to deal with these things. But far too long, some of the communities with the most jobs, with the most resources and the most ability to address things are saying, well, gee, these aren't our issues. That's Ferguson's problem. That's the city of St. Louis's problem. That is, you know, Little Rock's problem. So it's not our problem because it's not within our jurisdiction. This is all of our problem. And I think that's basically, if I had to say anything about what we need to learn, we really need to learn how to broaden our perspectives and think about how we all really are in this together and what we can do to take this anger, to take this high emotion, to take this energy that's really come out of the Ferguson tragedy and make something good out of it. And again, not just, you know, lip service, but something that's really meaningful. So that's a challenge for all of us. So I'll just close and say thank you so much for giving me the opportunity, and thank you for your focusing on this very, very important issue. Thank you very much.
Thanks, man. All right. I think most of you know that, you know, the connection and the proximity between St. Louis and Ferguson. The mayor dispatched his police department into Ferguson. It was very helpful in terms of trying to calm the issues going on. But the mayor has not shied away from this issue. Around the country, he has stood up and talked about it forcefully, admitted certain things aren't done as well, and then other things we can do better. And these are the kind of dialogues certainly we can have in this room. It's hard to have in our community if you don't have stand-up leadership. So we appreciate your leadership, Mayor. All right, at this time, I get to invite up Sam Dotson. He joined the St. Louis Metro Police Department in 1993 and rose steadily through the ranks. He became the chief of police in December of 2012. Prior to being the named chief, he served as operations director for the city of St. Louis. When the police shot an individual for brandishing a knife in St. Louis on August 19th, not far from Ferguson, some of you may have seen this video. Chief Dotson and Mayor Slade worked close and tirelessly with the public to get the information out and do it in a transparent manner. And in fact, all the tensions were allayed just because of the way they handled it. So, Chief Dotson.
Thank you.
All right.
Well, thank you. I always enjoy sharing a stage with Ron Davis from the cops office. I always learn something. I've never been on the stage with an NBA All-Star. But for us in law enforcement, the real rock star up here is Commissioner Ramsey. He is the gold standard in law enforcement. When we were having challenges in the St. Louis region, Commissioner Ramsey came to St. Louis and talked with the Missouri Highway Patrol, talked with the St. Louis County Police Department, talked with us to share perspective, to give us a outside view of things that, as you said, the optics do matter. So I wanted to thank you publicly for everything that you do, not just for us in St. Louis, but for the profession, and it is a profession. Thank you. The shooting of Michael Brown is the catalyst which brought to the forefront a much deeper conversation. Ferguson is emblematic of a problem. Decades and generations of social and economic disparity, years of profound underemployment, lack of educational opportunities, increases in black-on-black crime, lack of access to affordable health care, to mental health services. These are problems that impact a large segment of all of our communities. But what is important now is the narrative that Ferguson is writing for our nation is not finished yet. We have an opportunity, as many people have said, to impact that narrative and to turn the conversation into a positive way. Discussing race will forever be a difficult conversation in our world. And it's especially difficult for a white police chief in a community that's approaching 50% African American. However, it's exactly the reason why we need to be having the conversation, and I'm glad we're having it, not just here today, but in our community and in communities all over the country. Communities most impacted by crime need law enforcement the most, but those communities have come to fear law enforcement and fear the police as an occupying force. In some communities, police have become the face of government because government has failed to provide even the most basic of services. This creates a cycle of mistrust. And we want to talk about that cycle, but if we want to talk about that cycle, we must first understand its symptoms. Mistrust of police comes from a very basic level and sometimes occurs because of where someone is standing when they look at the problem. I'll give you an example. Mrs. Smith calls us because there are young men standing on the street corner who she thinks they're up to no good. When officers arrive, Mrs. Jones' grandson is one of those young men standing on the street corner. When we leave, Mrs. Smith is unsatisfied because the young men who were doing nothing are left on the corner, and Mrs. Jones is upset because we harassed her son. It leaves officers in a very difficult situation, but it leaves the community feeling that the police departments and the services that we provide really didn't address the core or root problems. These problems are real, but they are solvable. We can reach an understanding with both Mrs. Smith and Mrs. Jones. But first, we need to understand that we need to communicate candidly, transparently, directly, and frequently in those neighborhoods. Long term, I firmly believe, as was said earlier by President Clinton, that economics are the key. With growth and investment come better infrastructure, better accessibility to the things that we know curb crime, jobs, education, affordable health care, all of those. We talk about representative policing. However, really limiting the conversation to police doesn't do the conversation justice. The criminal justice system needs to be representative of the community that we live in. And when I say live in, I just don't mean where we lay our heads. Where we go to sporting events, where we vacation, where we dine, all need to be reflective of the communities. Law enforcement agencies must look for qualified applicants, ones that understand their implicit bias and ones that are reflective of the community they serve. I think we all can agree qualified applicants are a challenge, but they are the key to our successes. We have to compete for recruitment with companies like Anheuser-Busch, Boeing, GE, which compete for the same minority candidates, only pay much, much better than government. In my department, 2/3 of the applicants that apply for the Metropolitan Police Department are white. Less than 30% are African American, even though we serve a community that is approaching 50% African American. Representative policing is not just about the uniform, it's about justice, safety, and the rights we all share. We look for opportunities to keep our community safe. One of those rights is the right to dissent. Another is the public's right to know. Recent experiences with both social media and mainstream media have helped to reinforce an old lesson that my mother taught me. It's better to tell the truth than to let her find out and discover it on her own. It's better to face the criticism and answer them than let charges and rumors run rampant and go unchecked. The old days of saying no comment or not at this time are gone. People expect to know, and if we don't keep them adequately supplied with real information, they won't wait. They'll start guessing and speculating and creating a narrative, as we saw in Ferguson. Transparency used to be a choice for law enforcement. Now it's a fact. And facts are, things don't go away, even if we try to ignore them. At the same time, we can't afford to go on blind and tone deaf to the perception that we create. One of the most powerful lessons we learned in Ferguson became the public shock, and many in law enforcement and the profession in the region have criticized me for this. The war on terror style response that they saw in American cities created an optic that we can't ignore and we have to be able to address. But as police chiefs, we know there are situations when special weapons and tactics are absolutely necessary. But I also know that these cannot be the first or the only tools in our toolbox. We must be very careful and very creative in seeking ways to prevent violence without preventing democracy. Our citizens must be able to tell at a glance that they're not living in a third world country, in Damascus or the Ukraine. However they begin, these developments are trending in a positive direction. The issues that Ferguson has helped us face were with us long before Ferguson. And the things we must now do are overwhelmingly good. Things in many cases we were already doing. The cops office, for example, 20 years of history. In St. Louis, we started an in-car camera program 4 years ago. Why? Because even before Ferguson, we could see the value of the idea. We were recently removed from 150 years of state control and returned to home rule, which, except for Baltimore, I think everybody here can understand, puts local control and civilian review much closer to the electorate that we serve. Again, Ferguson merely helped to accelerate a trend that was already under its way. The same goes for workforce diversity. By regional standards, the St. Louis Metropolitan Police Department is already ahead regionally in proportional representation, but we have lots more work to do. Indeed, my regional leaders, including my boss, have long warned about the disadvantages of political fracturing in St. Louis, and the mayor addressed that. 90 municipalities, over 60 law enforcement agencies that range in size from the smallest, a six-man department, to the largest in the area, which is the Metropolitan Police Department of over 1,300 officers. And finally, let me say that we have no choice about there being a Ferguson effect. There will be a Ferguson effect that scholars will write about in years to come. The question is, what will that effect be? Up until this point, the Ferguson effect has meant many negative things. Emboldened criminals, frightened citizens, distrustful juries, wary public servants, confrontational media. But that is not how the story has to end. If we do things right, years from now, people will speak about the Ferguson effect as an important turning point in America's civic life. They will look back on this as a historic moment of reform where real change occurred, but only if we in this room do it correctly. The word police has become generic in some conversations. The conversations is just not about specific issues like workforce diversity, profiling, civilian oversight, or body cameras. It's about having a justice system and a process that works for all, including black, white, male, female, gay, lesbian, disenfranchised, rich, or poor. Representative policing is about having a system that works for all of us. I'm encouraged by the conversation today, but not just about the symptoms that manifest themselves, but about the solutions and the causes for the symptoms that we see in Ferguson. So thank you for the opportunity to talk to you today about what's happening in St. Louis and Ferguson.
Awesome.
Can I take that? All right, so what we're gonna do now is you've heard from four speakers up here. We'd love to hear questions from the audience. If you have a question about Ferguson or an insider or perspective, now would be the time. We'll start from my right. Mayor Schneider, you're up.
Thank you. Helene Schneider, Mayor of City of Santa Barbara. Thank you for all those perspectives. And I particularly appreciate, Mr. Davis, you're talking about the trust, the optics matter, crisis management, and monitoring the social media. My question has to do with, I'd love to get your perspectives of when something happens, that key moment, hopefully when there is a pause, because there is some trust, how mayors and law enforcement work together in communicating the right message at the right time to the community, to the media, especially if it's something that relates to a police department where there are certain rights and responsibilities in an investigation. What are some key points we should keep in mind in communicating with each other and keeping our message consistent to the press?
I'll start, but then I'll turn it to the chiefs. I think the first thing is, I think the old way of waiting till you get all the facts to provide something to the media just doesn't work. And I think you have to provide the public, and I'm going to say the public and the media interchangeably, the public a response, I would say, timely. And I think you tell them what you know. I think you made it clear. I think Chief Dotson did this in St. Louis, which worked very well, is telling them what you know at this time. This is all you know, but giving them something. So it's not a question of you don't want to tell as much as you don't have all the information, but I will share with you what I do have. So I think part of it is timely release of information so that it appears that it is the reality that the department is being transparent. I think the other thing I would say for the police chief and the mayor as far as the crisis management is I think crisis management is probably one of the easier part. I think, but that makes the assumption that people actually knew they were in a crisis. I think crisis recognition is where we fail, is the ability to know right then and there that you're actually in a crisis before the demonstrations, before it gets out of control, so that you are communicating, you're getting ahead of it, you're calling your mayors, everyone is prepared to respond versus now you're reacting to in a crisis that's already occurred. So I would say timely, accurate information, what you know, what you don't. Working within, obviously, the guidelines of law, because each state is different with regards to what you can say about officers, but I would still say timely.
Commissioner, do you want to add, or Chief?
Well, I think that it's very important that there be close coordination and communication between the mayor and the police chief with regular updates to the public, not just in front of a camera, but also utilizing and leveraging social media to get information out, because you have to get as much out as possible in a responsible way. I think that we need to make it clear and constantly tell people that as more becomes known through the course of an investigation, certain facts may change. You know, the first thing is the first story is never the right story. I guarantee you there are going to be some differences as time goes on, and people need to understand that. And I think they do understand that. But you know, you can't wait to have just your regular hourly or two times a news cycle updates depending on the severity of it. You have to be able to have your finger on the pulse of the environment. I think as police, we have to be willing to sometimes change protocol when it's appropriate. It's one thing for, you know, the manual to say that you don't disturb a body until after the ME and this, that, and the other. But let me tell you something. You can be on a hot scene. Well, you better do something and get that body out of there, or at least protect it using a curtain or something so that it's not that visible. I mean, you have to sometimes make those decisions and be able to stand them up simply because the environment is such where it's just not, you just can't follow normal protocol. So I think it's good communication, single point though. Now everybody shouldn't be talking to the press, but making sure that people who need to be spokespersons have the information they need to be able to pass it on to the public in any format that's available, whether it's TV, Twitter, or whatever it may be.
Okay, just one thing I wanted to add to the commissioner's comments. We also went into the neighborhood and started talking to individuals in the neighborhood, and Mayor Slay began calling opinion leaders in our community, so they had the information firsthand. So it's not just with the media, but it's actually almost a door-by-door, block-by-block conversation that's going on in our neighborhoods.
And it doesn't start with the tragedy itself. One thing our chief has done very well is he is out in the community all the time, going to community meetings. He is raised and talking with the press and being forthright and addressing issues. So he has built a level of credibility within the community generally. So when something does happen and he does talk, he talks with a higher level of trust and credibility. So that's important as well.
Mayor Marks, and please identify yourself and your city just in case folks don't know.
I'm John Marks, mayor of the city of Tallahassee, Florida, and I'm glad to be here. Thank you, Mr. President, for this. How many of you are aware that about 2 weeks ago, an African-American woman in a neighborhood was tased in the back as she walked away from a police officer? Three people. That happened in Tallahassee about 2 weeks ago. And I'm glad to see only three people raise their hand, because my chief did the right thing. And Chief DeLeo is with me. And everything that you all are just talking about, Chief DeLeo did it. Now, Chief DeLeo came after we had an incident prior to that about a year or so ago. We had to hire a new chief. And he's only been on the job 10 months now. But he understood what we need to have in our community. And I'm going to let him tell you what he did in addressing that incident with a 61-year-old grandmother was tased in the back as she walked away from a police officer. Chief DeLeo.
Thank you.
Well, you're in a hot seat. We're going to hear how you handled this.
How we handled, well, I wasn't the one that did the tasing, so let's make that clear. So that's how, like the mayor said, I was brought to Tallahassee less than a year ago after some other use of force incidents. We've had some certainly challenges in the short time I've been here. We've had some other use of force issues. But I think, like you just said, with Chief Dodson going out and establishing those relationships early on, and I think it was funny, a few weeks ago we had the PERF meeting and symposium, and one of the chiefs mentioned that he's not sure what church he goes to anymore because he spends more time at other churches. You know, those are the relationships. This incident occurred about 5:30 in the afternoon. Of course, bad news like that doesn't travel right away. I found out probably about 10 o'clock at night that we were told that there might be a video of one of our officers tasing somebody. So of course, everyone's scrambling out trying to find the video. Probably about 10:30, we find it. Obviously, I called my boss, assistant city manager at the time. He said he was having a good night. I told him I was prepared to ruin that for him. And we kind of all headed to the PD to start kind of figure out what's going on. I saw the video. You can go to CNN, you can go to local Tallahassee Democrat. I mean, it's out there. But what we did is we had a plan in place that once this occurred, once we knew about it, we looked at it. We did wait for the police reports to come in. At 2 o'clock in the morning, I called a press conference. My city manager, who's been very good to me and patient, because obviously there's a learning curve here for me. This is my first chief's job. Hopefully it lasts a long time. She said, no one's going to show up, you're nuts. 3 o'clock in the morning, everybody was there. And we released the video, we released the police reports, and made the announcement that the officer had been placed on administrative leave pending the internal investigation, answered whatever questions I could, because Florida law prohibits once the IA starts, that's you can't talk about that case anymore. So what we did is proactively, we put everything out right away. We released the video. We released all the police reports. Like I said, I waited for police reports to make sure there wasn't something in there that we weren't missing that wasn't conveyed in the video. We had as much information as possible, made the decision, relieved the officer of duty. And then, like I said, we proactively released everything, kind of short-circuited the news cycle. And it wasn't us responding to the community, but it was us coming out. And we talk about transparency and being out in front. So, of course, some of the reporters were less than happy about getting woken up, but the fact is if we waited till 7 o'clock in the morning, somebody else would have already been asking us about it. It was already on Facebook. It was already on YouTube. So I just say we kind of beat them to the punch, but we put it out first. So, yes, it's a story. We certainly saw some issues, and I know there'll be some challenges as we go through the investigative process, but we've gotten that pause that you mentioned, that the community was okay. Obviously, we're not happy about the incident, but let's see what you do with it. So that's where we're at right now with that.
Awesome. Thank you very much. Chuck?
Yeah, just to add on to what you said, you were at a meeting we had in Chicago a few weeks ago in which the police chief of Dallas, because you all were talking about the media, made the point that he was very sensitive to a news cycle. So for you to have a press conference at 2 o'clock in the morning, people would say, why would you have a press conference? Who would come at 2 o'clock in the morning? And so you reached out to them. But I think that has the whole, I mean, that says more about transparency than any policy, you know, that you can write. And so you got ahead of it. I wanted to make a comment and connect it to what you're talking about here, the panel, about what President Clinton, in the Clinton Library, said today, which I thought was really fascinating, about Los Angeles. He said, while the Ferguson incident occurred, Los Angeles had an officer-involved shooting. As a matter of fact, there were a number of officer-involved shootings during the same period. Philadelphia might have had one, right? Los Angeles had one. What President Clinton said today, which I thought was very poignant, is why wasn't there a reaction in Los Angeles when there was in Ferguson? And the point is all of the work that the city of Los Angeles has done to transform themselves. The reality is incidents are going to happen, whether it's, you know, Baltimore, Philadelphia, St. Louis, and it's what you do, not during the incident, but before the incident. You know, Leonard Muhammad, the Nation of Islam in Chicago, says, make friends before you need them. So there's all this work that has to be done. So if you do that and you do get the information out, and then what happens after the incident? Look, in Ferguson, the worst thing that they could do is to say, we're going to release the name of the officer, and then the next day say, we can't release it then. Because then people get this sense there must be something wrong why they're not doing it. So you take the combination of not doing anything before. The incident itself becomes a less significant thing. It's what you do afterwards that shows whether or not you're transparent, how you respond. So I think those are the lessons we could take. But I think we should think about what Bill Clinton said here today, 20 years. I mean, does he know policing or what? That he made these kind of observations that are still poignant 20 years later.
Thank you. Chief Robert Lehner.
Chicago that I think is relevant for this conversation, so I just wanted to introduce it, especially with mayors present. And that was the advice that we chiefs get when we need to do crisis management from city attorneys. In almost all cases, well, I've worked in three different police departments now in three different states, and in every single case, there was a need for the chief to stand up, say, we screwed this up, and be forthright and outgoing about what was screwed up and how. And in all three cases, I had a city attorney tell me, no, don't do that. And one of the things we talked about is how we have to be tougher about recognizing when we need to put something out and then put it out. And we will deal with the consequences. But that was an important point of that meeting that I think needs to be said.
I'll tell you what's interesting. Everybody in the room nodded their head when you started talking on that comment. So appreciate that. Mayor Finch?
I hope that when we talk about gangs and guns, we talk about the other 1990s great accomplishment with the assault weapons ban and how we can get back to some sensible gun laws in the United States. And we may not want to talk about it now, but one of the things that it being from a strong union state, I wonder if the panel could comment about attempts to reach out to organized labor that often defends bad cops when we are trying to clean up our police department.
If I can start for the collaborative reform process, and I'll speak for the pattern of practice. So we're working with St. Louis County to do a voluntary process of reform and looking at it, and we're also asking them to help us provide the services to the rest of the county, the 60-plus police departments that Chief Dotson mentioned and the mayor mentioned. But while we were down there, I also met with the FOP, the state FOP, because, and I made it clear to them, I don't know how you move forward without them. In other words, at the end of the day, regardless of what policy you applied, no matter what edict you say from your podium or from your desk, it's going to be an officer at 2 o'clock in the morning that he or she will make that decision or not. And I think to have them on board, I think most of the consent decrees are more successful when you have them on board about the reform. So I think I'm glad you asked the question, because I think bringing labor in is a significant part of any reform process. But at the same time, in many cases, we're hearing when we announce that we're going to provide assistance to an agency that the union may push back. And quite often it's because they're afraid of changing the status quo. They're afraid they'll try to make you afraid that it will be depolicing and it's other things. And I think this is where the strength of leadership comes in. If you know you need to reform, in some cases, that reform will ultimately benefit the officers more than they may even realize at the time they're asking for it. Just think about where we're at with body cameras. The initial pilot phasing in the 90s, how many cops were, and I was a cop at the time, how many cops were opposed to it. Now they're clearing cameras probably clear 95% of the cases they're involved with versus actually indicting the officers, and you see less resistance. So in some cases, it's educating the rank and file, it's bringing them to the table. In many cases, and quite frankly, it's just the strength of leadership making the decision regardless of the threat of no confidence and the other threats that will come into the table.
Commissioner Ramsey.
Well, you raise a good point, but it's not just the unions defending police officers that really should not be police officers. There are times when our own internal affairs do shoddy investigations that just don't stand up during an arbitration hearing. I go to a lot of arbitration hearings. But also, we have an issue with district attorneys charging officers for criminal offenses. They're reluctant to do it in many instances. And you have a good case, a solid case, you bring it to the DA, they sit on it for 6 months. If you're lucky, it's only 6 months. And then they give it back to you, and then the whole thing becomes, well, you know, there were no charges placed, there were this, that, and the other. And I mean, you're talking about cases of domestic violence, you're talking about cases of theft. And they ask a question, you know, I got asked the question, well, it was only, you know, $50 worth of stuff that was stolen. Well, excuse me, it should be zero. Thou shalt not steal, especially if you're a police officer. So, I mean, you know, but that's the kind of nonsense that you have to deal with. And the arbitration system itself is flawed. When the union and management both have to choose an arbitrator, and that's how they make their living, how many jobs do you think they're going to get if they go against the union too often? They're not going to get very many. So the system is flawed, and part of the problem is we have a lot of people in our ranks that should not be police officers, period.
Mayor Stidell, you have a question? We got time for a couple more questions. Mayor?
I do. Thank you. Having been a city attorney and a prosecutor, I want you to know I've taken the handcuffs off. I'm unshackled from those responsibilities of giving advice. I have to take that advice, and I think it's a very good point that was made about standing up and fessing up when necessary. But the question I have, President Johnson, you alluded to it when you talked about some of the issues of lessons learned dealing with the issue of recruitment, and Chief Dotson, you mentioned the issue of recruitment. I'd like the panel to comment a little bit on that issue. It's obvious that from Ferguson, the racial disparity between the composition of the police department and the community was totally out of whack. And but at the same time, I know that we all face the challenge of qualified people applying to the police department, and those increasing requirements oftentimes work in a very disparate way on that issue of racial balance in our police departments. And we've had some urging by various groups that we lessen the qualification, the entry qualification issues, so that we can have greater balance on that issue. That's a challenge unto itself, and I think that, you know, one of the real problems in Ferguson was the tremendous disparity between the composition, the racial composition of that police department and the community. So I'm curious to know what you police chiefs do about those things as it relates to trying to make sure that you've got a better balance.
Mayor, I want to add on to your question, because I think it was the one that a lot of us are interested in. You know, in terms of Ferguson, as the mayor said, nearly 70% African-American, and yet the police department is less than 2%. There was 3 out of 50-some-odd officers. In Sacramento, my chief and I, we're trying to figure out how to create a more diverse police force as well. So we'd love to hear Commissioner Ramsey, Ron, and Dotson here, your thoughts on it.
Well, I'll start off. It is a struggle to try to recruit in some of our communities, African-American communities, certainly being one, Hispanic community.
being another. And I think the other thing, though, that we have to realize is that neighborhoods change a lot faster than police forces change. People get on the job, they stay 20, 30 years. So you've got a period of time when whoever it is you got them. And at 30 years ago, the demographics were one way, and now 30 years later, there's something else. So the transition has to take place over time. But we have to constantly work toward trying to do a better job of getting people interested in law enforcement, especially those that probably would not have otherwise been interested in a career in law enforcement. I joined law enforcement back in 1968. For an African-American, it wasn't the best career choice I could have probably made in the middle of the civil rights movement and all the images you had about police and all the things going on. And I was actually a pre-med student at the University of Illinois. I had never thought about being a police officer. It just kind of accidentally happened. So you got to reach and touch those folks that wouldn't otherwise probably have become police officers, and that's a constant struggle. But every time we have a Ferguson, every time we have another incident, there are people that look at that and say, you know, why should I do that? As a side note, even the discussions around pensions and all the other stuff, if I'm a young person going into a business and I'm thinking about 20 years from now, 30 years from now, how am I going to support myself and my family, and there's a lot of discussion that they'll no longer be public pensions, why would I do that when I could go somewhere else and have a little more security? It's not any one thing. It's a combination of things. And I think that we have to really look at it, really go after people, provide them some kind of security and support, and be able to, you know, constantly, even though your demographics may not show it now, anticipate the future, anticipate the trends, start recruiting now for what you're going to look like 10 years from now, 20 years from now.
Director Ryan?
I would just, I won't repeat the points that Chuck made, but I would say start from the inside out. I mean, for the agencies that are struggling with relationships with minority community, that's probably your greatest recruitment tool or distraction or detraction. And so if I look at an organization as an African-American and I say, do I want to join this organization? Are you asking me to join something that I'm a part of, that I can grow and I can look at the organization and see someone that looks like me at every level of the organization? Or are you asking me to be a maverick? In other words, I got to fight every day just to get the dignity and respect that I'm supposed to have. I got to fight for every level. I got to fight. And if I have to do that, then I probably, as I have options, will not go that route. So I think Chuck's 100% right. The other thing I would say is I think diversity means a lot because diverse views are better decisions. But I think it's not happening here, but we have to be careful around the country that we don't oversimplify this as a solution. And many communities of colors will tell you that a minority officer will be just as disrespectful as a non-minority officer. And so I think until we get the time through the attrition to get to where we need to be into recruitment, we still need to work on how our officers behave every day. They treat people with respect. That's a part of recruitment. I would tell Chief, simply going to an historical black college ain't going to do it. You got to basically treat people with respect. You got to kind of march with your preaching. You got to look inside the organization. But make sure the officers you have are providing a service. And I think the more better service they provide, the less you'll have the demand for accountability. The voice for diversity is saying, I don't think you understand where I'm coming from, as one of the mayors said earlier. You can't appreciate me, you don't respect me, so maybe, I'm just hoping if you look like me, then you would do that. And then when they see that that doesn't occur, then you start getting to that, as Chuck Ramsey said, that 1%. So I think we need to get there, but I just want to make sure we don't oversimplify it and think that's the solution to advancing community policing in this country.
I want to ask a question to folks in the audience real quick, either a mayor or a chief. Do one of you in your cities have a really diverse police force, and can you share one or two techniques that you've used? Yes, Sheriff.
Well, and I would speak of my first career, not the one I'm in now. The military, for example, it is important that the leadership in the military reflect the enlisted force so that they have people who they can look up to and say, I can be there one day. When I came in the Air Force, it was only 1.5% women. When I was the commander of Air Force ROTC, we had a concerted effort, it's called the Gold Bar Program, where we went into minority neighborhoods, HBCUs, Hispanic colleges and universities, where we focused on recruiting individuals to become leaders in the armed forces. We have to do the same thing in our communities with law enforcement. If we are not focused on finding individuals who are qualified from across all of those minorities and majority that are represented in our communities, we're not doing the job that's important, because not only does the leadership need to reflect the community and the enlisted force in this case, but in our case, law enforcement needs to reflect the makeup of the community. I was very fortunate. We probably 6% African American, 6 to 7% African American in San Antonio and Bexar County, about 60% Hispanic, 33% Anglo. Where we were not in line is that we have very few women, and there's a lot of opportunity for women in law enforcement and corrections. And so we used the media to help us recruit and to advertise recruiting events. And the San Antonio Police Department does the same thing as it relates to African Americans, women, Hispanics, where they are looking for officers to join their ranks, but you have to do it in a very defined way to where you get what you're looking for. You can't just leave it to chance and put an advertisement in the paper or on TV saying you're hiring.
Okay, thank you. Mayor Doyle, did you have a question? And Mayor Hart, last two. Yep. Okay. Mayor Hart.
We have the same problem that everyone else has in New Haven in terms of diversity, but we also have portfolio schools. And so what we have done is make one of our high schools have an academy. It's Public Safety Academy. And in that Public Safety Academy, you can begin to get stackable certificates so that you can use those certificates once you graduate to already be a little bit ahead of the game. And also, we've partnered with the Henry C. Lee Institute at University of New Haven, which basically gives college credit in criminal justice to kids in high school. And so we believe by doing this in this particular high school that we'll have people that are in the pipeline for both police and fire, because there's a similar problem in fire as well.
Awesome. Thanks for that comment. Okay, let's Chief Mullen. To Mike.
Is look at non-traditional areas for recruitment. One of the huge successes that we've had is through internships with local colleges and going out specifically to athletic teams, women's basketball, women's track, and to look for female applicants. But we've had success constantly with having interns that come into the organization, as well as the mayor here just said. We've got programs where we bring in young people when they're 18, 19 years old, and they start working as community service officers for us, and then they continue to move up through the organization. And then internally, our officers, as the director said, is one of the biggest recruiters that we have, and we're very close to being representative of our community in terms of diversity, not only at the lower levels, but also through the command staff. So it really does work. I mean, if you've got that that look and you've got the people that are out there, and they can demonstrate that if you come into the organization, you've got the ability not only to be successful, but to move up into command positions, it really encourages other people to come into that organization.
Awesome. All right, as we wrap up this program, mayors, get your pens out. Chiefs, get your pens out. I have you write this down real quick. Come on, Mayor Finch. Mayor Dean, oh, you got your computer. You're ready. All right, write it down. Mayor Johnson at Kevin Johnson. So Mayor Johnson at KevinJohnson.com. So anybody who has a great technique for creating diversity, email it to me. And our chief and I, we're thankful to you, and then we're going to give you all the credit when we diversify our police force. If I don't hear from anybody, that is just bad news. So we hope to get some good ideas, and then we in Sacramento are going to take the best ideas and put them to work in Sacramento. Let's give our panelists a round of applause.